Hey, folks, this is Grok TV, a.k.a. GraniteGrok.com. We are still here at the National Heritage Center for Constitutional Studies, Constitution Day. It's been kind of slow. We originally thought that we'd be live casting all of the seminars. They happen to be put in other rooms, so yay. So as Rich Gerard and I said earlier, we were just twiddling our thumbs, so we figured we would talk instead of just twiddle. And I'm glad to have long-term Granite Grok friend Diane Bitter with us right now for a little bit until the seminars break up, and then she's got to go out and do booth duty, basically. Thank you for spending more than a few minutes with Granite Grok.
Well, thank you, Skip. Thanks for asking me. It was pretty boring out there in the hall.
Yep, but you had the chance to talk with Alan Keyes, the keynote speaker, a couple of times.
Ambassador Keyes was holding forth in the hallway.
Yes, he was, because I had to keep on saying, excuse me, may I get by? It's really hard with equipment. Right. But anyways, you are here, not so much just to listen to the seminars, because you haven't, but you've got a button on your blouse, your jacket,
my
the 603 jacket. Alliance.
603 Alliance, yes.
So tell our folks out there that will listen, who are either listening live or will be listening to our podcast at GraniteGrok.com, as well as lots of other places, what is it that you are doing with the 603 Alliance?
Well, the 603 Alliance is a new organization that is dedicated to educating our voting populace about the need for a constitutional conservative president. One that's going to follow the Constitution and not trash it.
Gee, what a concept.
Isn't that amazing? Anyway, that's really what got us motivated to put this together. And one of our first projects, this group officially began forming in January of this year. And we've had a couple of events leading up to our big project, which is going to be a caucus, the first ever caucus in the state of New Hampshire, unofficial.
And I'm glad you said unofficial.
Unofficial.
But
it's going to matter because we are first in the nation, and this is going to ripple out across the country with the news. The date of it is October 17th, which is a Saturday. It's going to be held at the Hopkinton Fairgrounds. We were looking for a location that was going to be more central to the whole state and also large enough that it could accommodate a huge crowd. This facility, the Durgin Pulling Arena, can actually seat 2,500 people. If we're standing, it can hold 5,000. So we need a big, big turnout of people to come. It's free. A registered voter who's either a Republican or an undeclared voter is welcome to come and participate in the caucus.
Now, there's another word for undeclared voter that's independent. Because a lot of people don't understand undeclared.
Okay. The official term, undeclared. But, yes, that would be it.
So what is it that you hope to accomplish with this? Now, I have to admit, I am a sort of a lapsed founding member of the steering committee here, but just things have happened, so I haven't been able to really play well in with the group's organizing. Oh gosh, it's not even 4 o'clock in the afternoon and I can't talk. Organizing efforts.
Yes.
But certainly I agree with the founding principle. So what is it you want to accomplish after this caucus, which is driving the established Republicans crazy?
That is driving them crazy, isn't it? I love that. Well, anyway, the point is that we have so many candidates in the race right now. As we all know, we have a long lineup of them. There are many good constitutional conservatives in the group. And among the voters, they've chosen who their particular favorite is in this lineup. However, if we split our vote by each of these candidates getting a little mini portion of the vote across so many voters, what ends up happening in the actual primary on February 9th is that the votes all get split and the moderate candidate can walk away with winning the primary in New Hampshire with perhaps only 20% of the vote.
And we have seen this over and over again.
Yes.
Here in New Hampshire, where you get two conservatives, say in a congressional district race, one moderate, and in the primary, the votes are split, and ain't nobody happy afterwards.
That's right. And we end up with the moderate who can't win, in the general, and then we lose everything.
That is absolutely correct, because that's how Ann Custer got her present seat. Mm-hmm. Well, partly, you know, name. Who was in the seat before? The Republican, semi.
In CD2?
Yeah. Before Ann Custer, what was his name? I'm drawing a blank.
I'm getting a
blank.
We're locked.
But he ran as a progressive Republican.
Yeah.
And his father had started.
It'll come to me later.
Yeah, it will. And his father had started the progressive Republican movement here in New Hampshire. Mm-hmm. And a lot of us were really put off because to us, and this speaks to the main purpose. To me, winning is only a precursor. It's what you do afterwards that's more important. But it seems that many in the Republican Party only care about that first clause, winning. There is no precursor. That is the beginning, end, and the middle, and that's all that counts. And that any person with an R after their name is a good one. And we all know that with respect to constitutional affairs, that isn't true.
It's not true. Correct. So what we're attempting to do with the caucus is to get people to be aware of the fact that we need to unite. Because in order to be meaningful about this process, we have to have enough numbers to win and beat the moderate candidate. And that means that maybe some of us have to go with our second choice or our third choice in the presidential primary.
Right. And some people may have some real angst about that. For instance, let's say I'm a Ted Cruz fan. Okay? I think I've made my stance that he's a constitutionalist and he's the guy I want to vote for. Let's say that Donald Trump brings in a lot of people, or Carly Fiorina pulls in a lot of people, or even Jeb Bush pulls in a lot of people. Would it be self-defeating if somebody that a lot of people think, because of their stances, isn't as conservative as need be, comes in and kind of upsets the apple cart? Because you are not making, as opposed to what a lot of people have been saying, you have said this is a clear field. You are not picking only those that you would allow in. This is free and open.
For everyone. We have to. If there's going to be any credibility about this whole process, we have to include every candidate. But if you look at the numbers, it's simple math. What is going to happen, process of elimination, as we go through the rounds, the first voting round, we will eliminate the two with the lowest number.
Oh, this could take a while with 16 people in this.
Yes. Well, we'll go try to do it quickly. We've got a process in place, and we'll be as efficient as we possibly can. In between the first go-round, the two lowest, then we give 15 minutes or 20 minutes to caucus for the other groups so that those people who've just lost their candidate, so to speak, in the caucus have to be assimilated into another group. So now that group is all, other groups are all going to try to get them to come with them. Now, what happens in the end, of course, as it gets round after round, as the groups get larger, in order for one of the candidates to walk away and set this up, as you say, by bringing in huge numbers, they would have to bring in more people than all of the others combined in order to do that.
This is true.
And it's just simply, I'm sure it's possible, but is it likely to happen? No.
No,
very
because
unlikely.
But let's just for instance, say if Jeb Bush was to do that. You're right. He'd have to really swap everybody because other than that, a lot of people might say, I don't care who the guy is. I'm not voting for Jeb Bush. Mm-hmm. We'll swing the other way.
And they will not go into that group.
Correct.
They will pull out.
All right. And you know, there are, even though I'm using Ted Cruz as a an example here, and a lot of us at Granite Grok have been accused of favoring Ted Cruz, at least in the early on, because, well, frankly, guys, he was the only one who was asking us to come in and do his events. Right. But there are a number of folks that I would certainly feel okay in voting for. There are those that I would not. But, yeah, I've made the decision. Mm-hmm. I am going to abide by the 603 Alliance decision, mm-hmm. although just before, I will certainly make it known who I favor.
Right.
I've already put one post out, who's my top tier and mm-hmm. who are my never will. But, you know, mm-hmm. we'll see going through. So switch gears a little bit. I kind of mentioned in passing that there are a whole lot of people rather upset. Now, I'm a former New Hampshire State Committee member, okay? Mm-hmm. Member, a formal member of the party. You were the secretary of the NHGOP. Mm-hmm. People aren't too hep with this at all.
By people, you mean the existing party members?
The existing power elite.
The executive committee.
Not even some of those that are on the committee. The movers and the shakers are none too pleased. Your comment on that. Mine only takes up two words. Screw you. Now, you can be much more polite because I get to say the stuff that most people can't.
Yes, Skip. It's not unexpected. I fully expected that because I did hold office for several years. I held office in the county as well. I also
and at the town level, if I remember
right. I was a town chair for 5 years.
Yep.
And, you know, I worked very hard during that time when I was an officer to try to bring people together, to make them see the side of not just where their establishment group was coming from, but the grassroots as well. And you know what? I wasn't real successful because I think they honestly feel that they're so right in what they're doing that they can't see the other side.
That is correct. I've been a member of a couple of movements to try to bring the factions together.
Yes.
And, you know, it doesn't help when you're outlied lied to your face.
Yes.
Here, we won't do this, and then the next day you open up the newspaper and go, what the?
And that's exactly what happens. And so after a while, you begin to not trust that they're going to be straight and true with you. And so, you know, I'm still being very straight and true and upfront, and I tell everybody exactly how I feel and exactly what's happening.
Yeah.
I give them all the information. I'm not holding back at all. I invite them to come and participate.
Yep. You know, and it is a big thing. You know, I've written about trust a lot in the run-ups to the elections. It is really a case that the GOP has brought upon themselves. When your base no longer trusts you, and I certainly put the Donald Trump phenomenon as prima facie example of that. If you had been doing your job all along the right way, you wouldn't have this going on. It is because this is going on, and you confirm this for me, Diane, because it is going on, it is showing that you messed up, and they're just blinded to this.
Mm-hmm. I think it's been going on for so long that the establishment feels that there can be no resistance. You just must go along with this because this is the way it's always been.
Yeah. Now, the whole reason why this is happening, and then I got to go run and save my cameras from the other rooms.
Uh-oh.
Yeah. The whole idea is that to gather all these people behind a single candidate, here in New Hampshire, where the turnout is not exactly stellar for a primary, mm-hmm. it only takes anywhere from 1,000 to 10,000 people to change the vote.
That's exactly
and I take
right.
it that's what you're looking to do.
Exactly.
So no longer splitting the vote, but using that whole idea against those that have been able to take advantage of it for years, even if they didn't have to do anything.
That's correct.
So
you've got it. Just a question of math.
It's simple. Math and bodies and will. and the ability to compromise a little bit. I don't think we're asking anybody to compromise their principles. That's not what this is about.
No, and in the end, people will have to do what their heart tells them to do.
Okay. Well, very good. Diane Bitter.
Thank you.
Part of the 603 Alliance here at the National Heritage Center for Constitutional Studies, Constitution Day. Say that 10 times fast, folks.
Whoa.
I want to say thank you very much for taking a few minutes with Granite Rock.
Thank you, Skip.
All right, folks.
Croc TV.